And Chris? What to say? I think there's two things, really, that I want to focus on this afternoon. And one is Australia's role regionally. So Hatchie's left the room, but did anyone else in the room deploy with him to Japan? No? Well, he did. And when he was there, he came across a few scenarios that were unexpected. One of them was a cow. And he actually, in his team, ended up having to do an emergency rescue on this cow that had been abandoned and left behind. So you never know. Some of you might be going up into that international USAR team and having a role in there. You mentioned before, Peter was saying how you've got the regional animal welfare strategy, which actually the Australian government has been a key driver of and is a member of. We sit on that regional strategy as an NGO, and it'll be good to see just where that goes and how Australia does play a part in it. But I think that's not so much the focus of today, huh? And tomorrow. It's what's happening here in Australia as well. So that's really the first slide is about the Earth, Rain and Fire Conference. So how many of you were at the Earth, Rain, Fire? Mark, I'm hoping you were there. No, not this year, maybe next year. But there's some other people that were, yeah? And that's, I think, probably you know who goes to that conference, right? That's all the big wigs with lots of badges on here and here and here. For the first time ever, Greg Eustace, who some of you might know from Queensland, organised an animal stream. And, you know, you kind of think, in the animal world, you know, vets and whatever, we'd probably normally duck down a little bit and be a bit nervous about going in front of a crowd of police commissioners and fire commissioners, etc. But we actually went there, we gave some talks, one of them was plenary, and we had lots of people coming up to us afterwards and saying, this is great, we support this, and this is a good way for us to be moving as state emergency services. So you can kind of feel, you know, sometimes when you're on the coal face of it, you can feel like, oh, the guys up the top, they're detached, they don't have a clue what's going on. Well, I'd like to say that, you know, we, the people that were giving these talks here, were a voice for you at that conference. And so what you're doing now has relevance all the way through. I started my disaster experience, I suppose, in Morocco, a relatively new vet. I'd been a James Herriot in the UK for about 5 years, and then I went off there, and they'd had a drought for 2 years. So this was a typical donkey car park at a souk or a local market, and this was the sort of body condition of animals that we were encountering. And it was interesting seeing some of the previous slides, body condition, vitally important to what your recovery is likely for your animals that you find. And we had plenty of those. Other things, though, you know, recognising this isn't an animal that's just been used, put on a slide and up onto the back. It's got tetanus. So we'd see, you know, 5 years of practice in Scotland, I saw one case of tetanus. Well, we saw, two a month in Morocco on average, just depending on which clinic I was in. So, you know, when you're going out to see your animals, yes, have the vet there. Maybe you have got one of those rare occasions where it's got tetanus. It's definitely going to be a different rescue scenario for that, I can tell you. Some things, you don't always have the right materials to put animals back together, particularly if you're out in the bush, and the inappropriate treatment. We don't want to be doing that either. I guess I really upped the ante a bit in 1999 when I went out to Kosovo, and that was roughly 1 week after the NATO forces went in. So, man-made disaster. This was a state farm with cattle, milking cows on it, that had been hit by a misdirected NATO bomb. Not so good. What you found was that it was an ethnic war, as you all know, and that when the Kosovan Serbs, who ran most of the state farms, saw that the game was up, they just bolted for it, and they just left all of their animals in their paddocks behind chains. Those that could get out found all sorts of places of refuge, and on the way they decided that actually the people's animals that they'd sort of confiscated in the meantime, they didn't have a use for them, and they didn't want the other people having, so that was not for euthanasia purposes. That's a type of economic cleansing. And this poor girl here, she'd been shot 5 or 6 times by the time I got there. And just, another thing just to show you how tough cows are. She survived, and when I went back a year later, she was in calf. But, you know, it was an ethnic war, and when the Kosovan Albanian side came back in as Muslims, you didn't want to be a pig, because then you had a different fate in mind. But now I work with WSPA, the World Society for the Protection of Animals, and you can see we've got our office here in Australia, which in Sydney is the head of the Australian WSPA, and it's also our regional office as well. But I live up in Thailand, which is where we base our disaster management team. In Australia, we don't do response work. We leave that for national SPCA societies. They're well-resourced, some of them. Queensland SPCA, when we came out to help in the floods, we weren't needed. What was needed, actually, was the relationship building between Queensland RSPCA and the Australian Veterinary Association for the rural response. Anyway, that's where we are. We're in about 15 offices around the world, 14, 15. The first major response I went to was Cyclone Nargis, which hit Myanmar in 2008. And this guy here, that's what was left of his total possessions. One cow and one calf. Family gone, house gone, just that. And he's... when we went out to this village, this was one that had been... They had 2,000 buffalo and cattle before the cyclone hit, and they had 30 afterwards. And they had about 1,500 pigs beforehand, and they had 20 pigs afterwards. So actually, those animals that survived, vitally important. Those buildings you see in the background were the central rice storage warehouses. Completely smashed, gone. That was the veterinary facility at Kunyangon, a small little township office. The vet there lost his wife and older son and barely survived himself. And then you've got the government eventually did the tally, and I guess the figures I'd point at would be this one here, 136,000 buffalo and 91,000 cattle, nearly 250,000 large animals gone, which to date, around less than 10% still have actually been replaced 5 years later. So we went out, we interviewed the people on the ground in this type of environment, but more importantly, really getting into the houses of people and talking to them, and remembering also the silent people as well, getting it all from disabled people, from children, women, and of course the community leaders. And with that, we came up with the question was, what went wrong? And what went wrong was that they didn't know that anything was coming. They didn't have any early warning system. They didn't have any system for how they could actually know that this was going to happen. So what we did, we went out, we basically taught them a system. We're coming up to about 200 villages where we've gone through, given them the basics as to how they can have a practical solution for early warnings. Through the radio, coming into certain community leaders, and then them disseminating through the flag system in terms of orange, prepare, red, get out of here. And that's gone down really well with local sirens and, but with their livelihoods and their food security with them. So we've done that to evacuate entire villages with their livestock. It takes a bit of preparation, but it's something that you've got to look to do. Triage systems. I think Chris, Professor Riley, is going to be talking about animal triage systems, telling them what's the difference between black, green, yellow, red. You guys know that. Anyway, this was the veterinary clinic, and that's what we replaced it with. They have the UN system, the idea of build it back better. So this was better. It's relatively cyclone resistant. Nargis is still a big challenge, but the vets that came back in there, we put them back in with a generator so that they had alternative power, so all the vaccines didn't go off when the power did, and a few other things like that. Now, you're all aware that the world's population is doing this. That graph won't be any surprise to anyone in this room. Maybe this one is a little bit more scary. When you look at this bit here and this statement, over the next 50 years, the world's farmers and ranchers will be called upon to produce more food than has been produced in the past 10,000 years, and to do so in environmentally sustainable ways. That's a challenge. And that's where, the veterinarians in the room, you'll be going, yep, we know, and it's hard, and how are we going to make our farming systems more productive? Probably intensify. It's what happens most occasions. Well, that actually makes them more vulnerable to natural disasters as well. And that's where you may find that as emergency services then, so how do you suddenly cope with an intensive agricultural system in terms of the previously extensive agricultural systems that you've probably dealt with? There can be a bit of a debate about global warming and climate change, etc. I gather it's quite robust in Australia sometimes. But This is a graph that was put out by CRED, which is the Centre for Research in the Epidemiology of Disasters. And I think in that one, there's some other graphs I can show which are a little more detailed, but you're clearly getting a lot more large-scale events. And it's a case of most of them happening in our region, unfortunately. And when we look at it from an Asia perspective, we look at probably South Asia as having a large impact zone as well, but really all across. And, you know, as the previous speakers were saying, we can expect more of these events in Australia as well coming up. But for us, as WSPA, we tend to focus our work for response in developing countries. And so looking at these areas in South Asia, you know, Little Oceania down here, we're not doing too badly. But then I think most of you in the room would probably beg to differ with that statement. But for us, we're focusing on this guy and trying to help him get back to a relatively normal life, if that's possible. But remembering also, he's coming from a rural background. Most people in the region are heading into cities. And for those of you in urban environments, that's going to be more work for you. So just to say, what is a disaster? Because I've heard it mentioned quite a few times today already. Let's just think about that. Some of you might think, oh, this is a disaster. This was on State Highway 1, and my cousin, who's a fireman in New Zealand, took these photos. Three horses got out onto State Highway 1. This one killed immediately on impact. Another one put down subsequently with a fractured femur. And the third one ended up here. And now, a bit tricky. And I know you're going to be seeing all of the right way to do this type of technical emergency rescue. I'll whiz through them not too fast, but at least you can see nobody's in a kick zone, and the person in the photograph there has got a helmet on, so Rebecca, we're doing okay on that so far. If I then say that this horse actually was recovered and did get out and survived. Yeah. So why did that happen? Yeah. How were they able to do that? Oh, sorry, no helmet now. We'll move on quickly. It's because of this sort of stuff. That, and thank you, Marianne, for some of the photos I've got up today. You know, training. If you guys aren't doing what you're doing today, you're not going to have a success like that. So, you know, I credit to you all for being here and doing this wonderful work that you're combining together to do. Because without it, I'll try and get this to work. And forgive me, I'm not blessed in the technology department, but we've had some... This was what some very well-meaning people were doing in Uttarakhand state, which had the big flash floods in India quite recently. There was a population of between 1 and 1,500 donkeys, mules, horses that took pilgrims up a hill. And this is the first ever successful mule rescue. There's a mule in the helicopter. Now, we saw the camel cluster before. What's the mule madness? Now, don't turn from the mule. The mule's the calmest one here, I can assure you. Bear in mind that when the first floods happen, they send out the emergency services in some planes, and one of them crashed within the first week. Because flying in these areas, visibility is very bad sometimes, and air currents not so good. The ships were more for truckers. But just looking at this, I wanted to show you the low-tech version as well, but I didn't think I had enough time. There's a low-tech version, which is actually really good. It's a guy getting out there with a rope. The mules swimming in this rapid flood water, and with this one here, yeah. Take us for that? Probably not going to see it again. There you go. So I imagine, you know, it's probably illegal in Australia, right, to put a mule in, inside the chopper. I'm thinking. I mean, just as a guess. But anyway, yeah. So. Yeah, so that's available on YouTube. If any of you want to have it, just Google GTS, I think was the term, wasn't it? But look, this is what happens as well. And this happened 2 days ago, 3 days ago. And there was some flooding in Myanmar. And some guys were trying to evacuate with their livestock. I haven't got the detailed report, but obviously there must have been lots of ropes involved and there was a bit of flood water around. And, you know, this is ultimately what happens when people are trying to do stuff that they're not trained to do. And, you know, this is the sad result, unfortunately. So what is a disaster? According to those people with the graph that I showed before over in Brussels, 10 or more people killed, 100 or more people reported affected, or a declaration of a state of emergency, or a call for international assistance. Interestingly, when we had the Dzud in Mongolia in 2010, so that's basically a drought, a short summer, not much food produced, and then an early and incredibly harsh winter. Temperatures went down to negative 47 degrees. And the Mongolian government, bless their cotton socks, didn't declare a state of emergency, didn't call for international assistance, and it took a long time. I mean, to say that 100 or more people affected, well, the whole damn country was affected. In the end, because none of those other things got flagged up, over 8 million animals died. Because of that. 30% of their livestock. So this graph, you know, you put it into the that sort of reality, there's a lot of stuff going on in the world out there, and we have to be ready for it, and we need to be helping. The thing that happened really, and I think we've already heard this, is that emergency services, disaster management sector in general, galvanized itself when we had the 2004 tsunami, and everyone kind of looked at that and went, oh, but, you know, that's Asia, and you know they don't have the right systems in place, etc. So you know it was harsh. It was a bad day, but you know, but then when it happened in America and with all the resources and everyone saying, oh well, you know they should have been able to be okay, and they weren't. I think those two things there together, in the proximity that they were, made the entire world wake up to what we need to do, and you know this is the stuff that we need to happen. In the US, they went and changed their legislation around it. FEMA had a complete overhaul, and they looked at it and came up with the PETS Act 2006. New Zealand. There are two people representing in New Zealand in the room. Neither of them are from New Zealand. One's American, the other one's Australian. I am a Kiwi, just out of for the record. Anyway. Well, I went back to New Zealand in 2005 and was working for the government with the MAF, as it was then called, and we formed NAWEM, the National Animal Welfare Emergency Management Group, which is still in existence and doing great. It's taken a while from that first stakeholder meeting, but then the Christchurch earthquake, I think, helped galvanise things, and NAWEM was sort of peripherally involved in that in a central coordination role, which is what you want it to be doing. It's not an on-the-ground thing anyway. But then Roger Poland, who's at the back of the room, who's working with the Ministry of Primary Industries, told me some great news just this morning, and that is that the MPI have now signed on the dotted line saying that they are the designated responsible animals, agency for animal welfare in adverse events. And that's what you want. It's what Chris was saying before. We need to go to a single point source for this stuff. We don't want to be going off, you know, to different areas. So well done to MPI for coming in and stepping up to the plate for that. It's a really good thing to see. And we've got some good news as well in Australia, which was what Peter was referring to. Now, you just as we said that globally we had the 2004 tsunami and then the 2005 Katrina, I think Australia too has had its galvanising moments. And the Victoria bushfires are certainly one of them. Yeah, and then the Queensland floods. This is... Queensland floods, and it's up in Brisbane, and it's actually at the RSPCA shelter that got flooded. And we've heard some talk about using social media. they got onto their Twitter site and their Facebook and what have you and said, hey guys, we need to evacuate 400 animals from our shelter. Can people come? They had 400 animals out of there within 2 hours. Great stuff. I mean, that's really social media working well. RSPCA also put out public service announcements to people in Brisbane saying, look, these are the likely flooded areas. If you've got animals, go and take them somewhere else where you're not going to have to think about them at the time we're telling you to evacuate. Another bit of great stuff, you know, using the media properly where it helps us. And I think that was another message before. Let's make sure we keep using it. So I think those events were a really good catalyst. And, you know, at the moment, well, I'm sure you will have a much better idea of what's happening in the last week and even today, so I won't go there. But these are some more photos from Marianne. But, this was when we went out to Lockyer Valley and saw what happened with the flash flood and just how it was a real land tsunami in its own right, really. But then, you know, some highlights, these iconic photographs that you've come up with as well that just really, you know, get a bit of emotion going in people, which is what you need to do, I think, sometimes to tell the story about what's happening. And just as Peter was saying before, the Australian Animal Welfare Strategy has helped a lot. And actually, Peter Thornburgh came with us to India and gave a presentation at the first national conference for India for animals in disasters. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that shortly. I'll tell you now. This was the conference. Peter's in there somewhere. But this conference got together the people from the National Disaster Management Authority. It's a group of 8 people for the entire country of India. The 8th member of that group is the Prime Minister. And you have the likes of Sri Reddy, who's the chair of that group, or vice chair of that group, with the Prime Minister. They declared last month that all states of India, all 28 states of India, should include animals in their disaster management plans. That's over 1 billion people that are now going to be looking at this question. So if they can do it, Australia was represented at that conference by Peter Thornburgh, and did a great job. He was telling them what you have already started to put in place at that point. And that was just back in March, April this year. And already the Indian government, they've seen how relevant it is to them. So that's where Australia has a regional influence as well. 2 weeks ago, I was at ARDEX, which again is it's a regional forum. It's the, as I say, Regional Disaster Emergency Response Simulation Exercise, shortened to ARDEX, opened by the Secretary General of ASEAN, the Deputy Prime Minister of Vietnam, and the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Development. And lots of generals, of course. It's Vietnam. But they were nice. They were friendly. It was good. And as they were nice and friendly, then you had this crowd. And this crowd was the civil society people. So this is where, actually, the United Nations, you name it, every forum has said that we can't do this just by governments. We need to involve civil society. So, you know, those of you that are putting on a government hat, actually, even though they may look like a bit of a motley crew, there's actually a lot of very clever people in there and a lot of capacity. In that group, you've got representatives from World Vision, Save the Children, Oxfam, CARE, and Whisper. We were there for the animals. This might be something many of you are a little more familiar with. So this was the collapse structure simulation. Quite an impressive simulation that they put on. Teams from Indonesia, Thailand, Brunei. Brunei's holding next year's one. Quite an impact. This was their level 2 emergency medical facility where they can take in 200 patients just toot sweet. But it didn't have any toilets. It's a shame. You run these simulations with the idea that you find out what the little loopholes and what the little problems are. So that was a small issue. But and this was actually, they did some other things. They did chemical simulations of spills and various other things. But this, to me, was the biggie. That pontoon has just been towed into place. It was about 500 metres long. And I should say that roughly there were about 2,500 people at this exercise, at this point in time. And now this is where I'll be technologically challenged again, but try to show you some little clips. So, that's actually it worked perfectly at lunch break. It was just working. But they had animals there. That's what got us so excited, or got me really excited. And then when the whistle went, that's it. 800 people evacuating with all of their possessions across that bridge to the other side. A big effort, big mobilisation. And with 2,500 people involved, no injury on the day. Himself can be a bit of a shovel. So they had animals there. I'd say they're token animals. I think when you saw the previous slides of us doing the village evacuations in Myanmar, the people-to-animals ratio changed quite a bit. But at least they had them there, the first time that they'd ever done that at this type of regional exercise. So that was great. I've cut that one short just because I'm a little bit worried about time. But they also had... really well done, considering the scale and a lot of planning. Yeah, there you go, cattle. Because it's evident in countries like Vietnam that they are dependent on their animals. They need, they need them for their food security. They need them for their livelihoods, for their income. The guys in India say that they won't evacuate unless they can take their animals with them, because no point. They might as well just abandon their kids because they won't have any food when they go back to them after the evacuation period is over. And even here, you know, coming off the... I thought this guy did an amazing job of just balancing it. He's got... for one, coming off a boat, you know, a little bit rocky, right? Carrying one of those things there, and what's he got? One side he's got some poultry, and the other side, the television. And that's not simulation, that really was a television. So, yeah. Anyway, no, there was a really, it was, and so on. Stop that and go back to this. So it really was well done, and I'm happy to say that actually the welfare of those animals involved in that simulation, top notch, no problem at all. You saw those chickens, ducks. They weren't fazed by that. They do that fairly regularly. But this is what they put up, just to remind us. And it's true, people's lives do come first, and that's what we've been hearing, you know, safety at the scene, absolutely, people first. But we were really happy to see that animals actually had some part in there, because without that, you're going to struggle. People always ask, what do you do when you show up somewhere and there's not been any humanitarian response? And I always show this picture. Some of you in the room, Haley, will be getting bored with this story, but this is the only village I've been to in emergency response that hadn't had any humanitarian response to it. And so we showed up there saying, hi, we're here to help your animals. It's that village I was telling you before that lost, you know, had 2,000 and went down to 30 and had 1,500 and went down to 20. And we showed up and said, hi, we're here, we're going to help your animals. And they were like, thank goodness. We're so happy that somebody's actually, you know, shown up. And that it was about animals? Oh, that was fine. No problem. For one thing, we were able to report it back into the system, get everyone else involved, right, you know, let's get the Red Cross out, et cetera, put them on the map. But actually, you know, and we always find this, if we show up in this sort of environment and say we're here to help animals, they go, great, bring it on. So, yeah. Now, just to, again, put in Australia's regional relevance, this lady here is from your Attorney General's office. She was over there looking to see what was going to go on and report back to the Attorney General's office, who I'm happy to say is also... on this, represent National Advisory Committee for Animals in Emergency. Catherine Bryan, her name is. And she works with other people like Gardner Murray, who's your ex-chief veterinary officer. And just listening to Hatchie's wonderful dream of you guys, you know, this committee, I would say, is a very good... Sorry, my... Whoops. Disaster. Sorry about that. Stop waving my hands around so much. But this is a committee that is designed for you to feed into, I would think. You know, emergency rescue is part of the picture about animals in disasters, and so this is a very good format for you to get involved with it. So, you know, some more discussions, maybe with Mark and some others later on. But, you know, there is no reason why you can't use this as a way forward to take... take this to the national level, which was what I was hearing this morning. Stakeholders have been present. We had the workshop in September, the third one that we've run, and just to update exactly about Victoria, as we heard before, 2 years ago, so at the first national workshop we ran, we heard how a guy from DPI, a veterinarian, Dwayne O'Brien, had started working on the Victoria State Plan. Then last year at the workshop, someone from DPI came and said, it's done, it's up on our website, anyone can go and look at it. And then a couple of months ago, we heard how not only have they got their state plan, they've also got roughly 80% of the local authorities also having a plan involving animals. So you're getting so close, you know, it's always getting that last kilometre. So, you know, this stuff's happening, it's happening in the other states as well, and we had a bit of an update before about South Australia, how that's moving on as well. But the states are actually moving on this, and it's been really good to see. Now, so that's kind of the regional stuff and a bit of Australian stuff. I wanted to now just sort of come into this area of vets and, you know, why vets. I think hearing Chris talking before lunch, you know, that's a vet helping an injured animal. But there's a lot more to it than just that. Animal care, epidemiology, bioterrorism. If you get an anthrax scare, we'll be there. Zoonotic diseases we've heard about already. Some leadership, sometimes there, sometimes not as much as we want. And the others on the other side. I can go through them all. But the one that is going to be interesting is this one, the ICS. Now, most vets will read that and go, intensive care syringe, or I don't know. But it's about getting veterinarians to understand the language of SES. Yep. And I think that's what this is all about. A conference like this is a wonderful format for that. We've been doing this thing called VERU, the Veterinary Emergency Response Units, globally. In Asia, we've been doing it in Thailand, India, Myanmar. And this is where we've been teaching undergraduate veterinary students the basics of emergency response for their country. What are the natural disasters that exist? Principles of disaster management. Animal handling, and that's obviously, that's something that, to be honest, we've been too scared to teach, really. Teaching undergraduates about the sort of things that we've been hearing this morning of, you know, it's a dangerous zone to be working in the first place. Do we really want undergraduates going in there? But can we not? Because they'll be exposed to it when they go out into practice anyway. So actually, isn't it better that they do have a bit more awareness about it? Emergency shelters, running emergency shelters, that's a big one. Feeding animals in disasters. Where do you get it from if you've just had a great big flood go through? What's the correct procedure? Assessments and operations. So that was when we went out after Cyclone Nargis. Philip Russell on the right, my old boss, and the Director General of the State Veterinary Service, looking at a map all in Myanmar language, going, right, okay. But it looks impressive. I think he looks like he knows what he's doing, which is great. But for us, it's always getting the community feedback as well. You know, we can look at it from the top, but we need to go to the ground truthing. What's the community facing? Doing deployment, pre-intervention, post-intervention, safety and security. Not sure whose photo that is we've stolen. Guilty. Apology. I got your name up on the other ones. And data collection. You know, so hard in these big disasters to get people actually recording what they're doing. Veterinary response, we again going back to the bushfires talk from Chris before, biosecurity. You know, we're at the moment in Cambodia, there is a huge outbreak of foot and mouth that the authorities are really struggling to control, so much so that the other neighbouring countries are having to put in border protection in addition. Why? Because there's a huge flood. So what's happened? All of those animals have moved around into new areas where they weren't normally going, etc., etc. So we need to think about these sort of issues. And then disaster risk reduction. Now, that's probably the biggest one that we actually want the vets to take out. When they graduate and go out into their communities, we want them to have an awareness about, if they go onto a farm, when I was a new graduate, I was taught, right, Ian, go onto the farm, wander around, have a look at it, check out how many of the dairy cows are lame, and then go and walk up and down the race and probably tell the farmer he's got too many stones in his race and he needs to redo his race. It's nothing to do with the cows, it's about the system. Well, this is exactly what we want the vet students to do for farming systems and for urban systems. Community awareness, that should be one of our roles, making our communities more resilient. So this is in Thailand. This is a bunch of undergraduate vet students. The original idea for veru training was, yep, these are a bunch of really enthusiastic people that we're going to get in and chuck them out and they're going to be really useful for us in the field. No. Wrong. I think you all know that. They're really great. They're wonderful. We do get them down to sometimes, you know, break down big sacks of dog food to little sacks of dog food, or to, you know, put some branding on some hay bales going out the door or something. But yeah, not in the zone, as it were. They're in the very cold zone, I think we'd call that. But great fun to teach and great fun to work with. So we've actually been doing this veru in, as I said, in many universities. There's 12 in Southeast Asia, in South Asia. There's about another dozen over in the Americas and around there as well. But then just to look at this work with the OIE, the World Animal Health Organization, we've been pushing them gently. They're in France, so you don't want to push them too hard, they'll react. But we've now got it to the point where we're looking at them forming what they call an ad hoc writing group, which will come out with what we want to be standards and guidelines for the global, or 178 countries that are part of the OIE, members of the OIE, of which Australia is one, as is New Zealand. Some minimum standards and guidelines. Now, don't worry, Australia will fly well over the top of them. These are guidelines that we need all of the countries of Africa, of Asia, to also sign into. So if there's anything in there that Australia is not happy with, I would be a little concerned. So don't be. So this is as Peter mentioned before, you are part of the regional animal welfare strategy, and that is Jim Paradise, who works with DAF, and Garden Murray hiding in the back there, your former chief veterinary officer. So Australia is very much aware of the regional role it can play. In terms of helping its export markets and lots of other things, but it is looking at the big picture. Then one of the last things I really wanted to come to, we're about right, ooh, good, is this thing called the Livestock Emergency Guidelines and Standards. And back in the Rwandan crisis, everyone's pretty, you know, familiar with that story of the genocide that went on and how the humanitarians failed in their duty to provide adequate services to those people that were in that crisis. And afterwards, they took a step back and had a look at what they did or didn't do. And they came up with a project called Sphere. And Sphere, the project, was all about getting these minimum standards if you're going to do a humanitarian response. If you're going to give people, basically, give them what they're asking for, not what you're telling them they need, is it in the short of it, you know? And so if you're going to provide water, there should be some standards. You can't just say, oh, here you go, I got this out of the river, drink that. Or, you know, in Myanmar, after Cyclone Nargis, the people ate rice, sure. Oh, let's go and give them rice. Well, actually, they produced some of the highest quality rice in the world. So when they were given these sacks of rice that was all just moldy and crumbled up, and they were like, that's not rice, you know? I mean, you'd think, oh, they'd be grateful for anything. Well, they would be, but, you know, at the same time, you know, that was rubbish, yeah. Banda Aceh, when the 2004 tsunami happened, Indonesia, predominantly Muslim country, one well-meaning group from a country which will remain nameless, but it's not in Australasia, sent over, I think, about 5 tons of spam, pork meat. That was good. Let's give people what they actually need rather than what you think they need. And so that's what the humanitarians went through, way back when, after Rwanda. And then we started to look at what's happening in livestock as well. And the story wasn't any better. And so people that had been dealing with livestock interventions and realizing how many of those were failing came up with this. And as I say, first edition 2009, it had around 1,700 organizations and individuals give input into it. So it's actually pretty much on the ball, but, you know, nothing's perfect. So we're looking at having a second edition next year. And I'll just a little bit of a run around on what it is. Now, because you always go into a large-scale disaster thinking, oh, where do I start? Well, this is actually a really nice way to start. And coming through, you see there's these common standards for livestock interventions, but then you break it down into six technical ones: destocking, provisioning veterinary services, feed supplies, water, giving water, giving shelter, resettlement, and then restocking. Now, you know, one of the ones I have a bit of a bugbear on is restocking, where you don't have those things up above: feed, water, shelter, and vet services correctly sorted. Because what I've seen, and it's usually one of the first things that a community will ask for, is, oh, can you please, you know, particularly in developing countries, can you give us some animals? We need some animals back, because that's what we do. We're farmers, we need our animals. And without those other things sorted out, I was talking to someone from a large humanitarian organisation. They'd resupplied some poultry to one of the villages, and I said, yeah, how'd that go? 120% mortality. So all that poultry that they gave died, and they introduced a new disease that wiped out a significant chunk of those that had survived. And that's not uncommon. That's the majority of livestock interventions that undertaken inappropriately will result in that. I've yet to have someone give me a really positive story about restocking soon after a disaster. You can do it, but you've got to have all your ducks in a line, literally. So this is something that was developed actually in sub-Saharan Africa for drought as a slow onset disaster. We've used it all around Asia for everything from floods to cyclones to drought to whatever, and it works. It's a set of basic principles, and something that we've taken that, for example, to the government of Vietnam, who have rolled it out as a national strategy for their response to disasters. Now, this is not emergency rescue. Don't get confused with that. But emergency rescue plays a part of it, and you as emergency responders should be also aware and a part of this. Or should you? Actually, is it relevant to Australia? These are all the trainings that we've done for it in the last couple of years in Asia Pacific, and there's been other ones in the Americas, etc. Every time I've put up this slide, though, in developed countries, they've actually gone, oh, well, actually, hold on, we don't actually have anything ourselves that much in place. So maybe this has some stuff, some relevance, and maybe some of it might be relevant for Australia. We know that in New Zealand, they're starting to look at it as well, thinking it might have some relevance. But and I'm good to go. Don't panic about that clock thing. This is something that we get involved with other organisations as well as government. The International Federation of the Red Cross, myself and a colleague have been trained in human shelter management. But while we were doing that, as a week course, they said, oh, while you're here, you wouldn't happen to come up with a job description for what we would do with someone who's going to look after all the animals that keep on showing up at these emergency evacuation centres. So, oh, okay, so we got busy, wrote something down, job done. So they've now got that as something up their sleeve for when they're doing IDPs, internal displaced people. So whether you're looking at this guy out in India with his one cow or maybe five cows, or you're looking at this sort of scenario, you know, you've got different disasters, different references for what is a disaster, but I think you all have to be part of the big picture and see that Australia is definitely part of the big picture. You're part of it as well. And just remember, you can never be too prepared. So this is Japan. You know, one of the countries we always think is the most prepared, most disaster resilient countries in the world. And look what happened. They had a tsunami. They had an earthquake that cracked their tsunami defences, and then boom, wallop, and then a nuclear incident that will haunt them for a long time. And were they prepared for their animals? No. They didn't have anything lined up for that. It went down to the... Because we deployed and went into the Japanese system, with working with the Japan Veterinary Medical Association, the Japan Animal Welfare Society, Japan Pet Food Company, a few other people. But we were independent. We were able to support ourselves, as USAR teams can and do, as did Australia, as did New Zealand. But I think when we were going through the airport, the Portuguese arrived. Have you got any translators? No. Who are you working with on the ground? No. Bye-bye. That was all that the UN did as their main UNDAC job was actually... The Japanese came to them and said, would you mind having a role to help us politely say no to all of these people that want to come in? That was the UN's main role in Japan over that. So that's really just a quick snapshot of what's going on in the region, some stuff about what's going on in Australia, and hopefully some of you can see how let's get this stuff all together and all working together forward. There you go. Thank you.